Hello, my name is Pierre-Olivier Fernagut. I am a preclinical researcher working on MSA. I would like to thank the MSA Coalition for organizing this patient and family conference and for inviting me to talk at alpha-synuclein and disease mechanisms in MSA. Let's start with a few words about alpha-synuclein. This protein was discovered in 1988. Then 5 years later, in 1993, there was the first link between alpha-synuclein and neurodegenerative disorders. And this was actually found in Alzheimer's disease, where alpha-synuclein was identified as a component of amyloid plaques. In 1998, alpha-synuclein was found in oligodendroglial cytoplasmic inclusions in MSA and in neuronal inclusions that are called Lewy bodies in Parkinson's disease and dementia with Lewy body. Then in 2001, an important study provided the first evidence that alpha-synuclein that is aggregated in Parkinson's disease and in MSA have distinct and different biochemical properties. So it was the first evidence that alpha-synuclein in PD and in MSA was different. Between 2010 and 2014, several groups have found that misfolded alpha-synuclein can initiate the aggregation of normal alpha-synuclein in the brain, and that this mechanism can amplify and self-propagate. More recently, in 2020, two different groups were able to identify MSA-specific forms of alpha-synuclein filament. A few words about the protein itself. It's a small protein, but quite abundant in the brain. It was initially found at the synapses, so the terminals of the neurons, and also in the nucleus of the neurons. And so that's why it was called synuclein. It was initially thought to be absent in mature oligodendrocytes, but this finding has been later challenged. The functions of alpha-synuclein are not entirely known. We know that it is involved in synaptic transmission, the chemical communication between the neurons that will release some vesicles containing neurotransmitters. And there is also evidence that alpha-synuclein can bind the DNA in the nucleus of the cell, but the exact function here remains to be fully understood. Now, just a few words about the life cycle of the protein. So it starts in the nucleus with a step that's called the transcription. The DNA opens up, and the transcription will lead to the synthesis of a messenger RNA. This messenger RNA will then exit the cell, and the genetic code that is encrypted on this messenger RNA will be read, and amino acids will be attached one to another in order to form a chain. This chain then undergoes several steps of folding so that the protein will adopt its structure, its conformation, its shape that is necessary for its biological activity. As you can see here, the shape of alpha-synuclein is quite simple. Here, as an example, you have the shape of a protein that has nothing to do with MSA, hemoglobin. And as you can see, some proteins have a quite complicated structure compared to alpha-synuclein. Once the protein has done its job in the cell, it needs to be degraded. There are two main degradation systems that allow the recycling of proteins. One of them is called the ubiquitin proteasome system, and the other one is called autophagy. Now, a few words about the aggregation process. So what goes wrong with alpha-synuclein? During the folding, the unfolded chain needs to undergo different steps of folding in order to adopt its normal conformation. Misfolding is when the folding does not work properly, leading to the generation of an aggregation-prone monomer. So a monomer is one unit of the protein that is abnormally folded. It has an abnormal conformation. Those aggregation-prone monomers will then assemble with each other to form what is called an oligomer. And then these oligomers will then also assemble in order to form amyloid fibrils. These fibrils can then form aggregates either in neuron or, in the case of MSA, in oligodendroglial inclusions. Here you can see in green alpha-synuclein aggregated in an oligodendrocyte. So what drives the selectivity of inclusion either in neurons or in oligodendrocyte is not entirely known for the moment. What can affect the aggregation process? There are actually many, many things that can affect the aggregation process. One of them being, for example, the presence of too much alpha-synuclein in the cell. This could be due, for example, to an increased production of the protein. It could be due also to an impaired degradation of the protein due to the failure of the clearance mechanisms I mentioned, autophagy and ubiquitin proteasome system. A third possibility leading to too much alpha-synuclein in the cell could be the uptake of alpha-synuclein that has been released by a neighboring cell and that would then enter the cell. All of these leading to too much alpha-synuclein in the cell and too much that the cell can handle. Then, dysfunction of some key cellular function can also play a role in the aggregation process. For example, a dysfunction of the protein folding mechanism is likely to promote the formation of aggregated form of alpha-synuclein. Also, a deficit of energy production can be involved, as well as a deficit of antioxidant defense mechanisms that will lead to the aggregation of alpha-synuclein. Also, the fact that other aggregation-prone proteins would be already present in the cells or other molecules that particularly interact with alpha-synuclein could play a role in the aggregation process. And finally, modifications of alpha-synuclein, and we'll come to that in more details later in the presentation, leading to different strains, could play a significant role in the disease process and the aggregation process. So, a few words now about the concept of alpha-synuclein strains. So, what are these strains? These strains are disease-specific conformation of alpha-synuclein, so some disease-specific forms of alpha-synuclein that are responsible for the cellular selectivity of inclusion formation, for neurodegeneration, and also for the pattern of progression of the disease that can be quite variable from one individual to another. This concept is based on the fact that MSA and related disease of the synucleinopathy family, like Parkinson's disease or dementia with Lewy body, are characterized by the aggregation of the same protein, alpha-synuclein, but in different cell types, oligodendrocytes for MSA, neurons for PD and DLB. Also, the fact that the progression and the propagation of alpha-synuclein aggregation in the brain are different between the three diseases. And finally, as I mentioned previously, some of the biochemical properties of alpha-synuclein, like its solubility and its propensity to initiate aggregation, are different between MSA, PD, and DLB. So all of these led to the concept of some disease-specific strains. And recently, in 2020, two very important studies have been able to identify this in more details. Here in this study, the researchers were able to image Parkinson's disease and MSA fibrils. And as you can see here, those fibrils that are twisted filaments are different between MSA and PD. Here is a drawing of these filaments. And as you can see, MSA filaments are much more twisted than PD filaments. In another study, researchers have been able to identify two types of MSA-specific strain from different patients, showing that part of the aggregation of alpha-synuclein is identical between the two strains, but part of the aggregated form is different and unique. I I'll give now a few words about the concept of prion-like spreading. So this concept is based on the properties of some protein, mainly the prion protein. And the prion protein, when it's misfolded, when it has an abnormal conformation, that's called PRPSC or scrappy, it can itself induce the misfolding of the normal prion protein. And so this is a self-amplification mechanism that will be responsible for the propagation of protein prion aggregation in the brain. Some studies have shown that like prion protein, misfolded alpha-synuclein can trigger the misfolding of normal alpha-synuclein and then initiate this self-amplification mechanisms. So this is one element of a prion property. But unlike prion diseases, MSA has some, and synucleinopathies have some difference. Prion diseases are transmissible between individuals. For the moment, no such evidence for MSA and other synucleinopathy has been shown of transmission between humans. Then the regional and the cellular selectivity of alpha-synuclein aggregation is not entirely compatible with a pure prion process. For example, in some cases, alpha-synuclein will aggregate in neurons or in oligodendrocytes, and all the regions in the brain are not affected the same way. And so all cells do not have an equal vulnerability to develop inclusions. You can have one cell with an alpha-synuclein inclusion and another cell next to it devoid of inclusions, meaning that there are some factors that are intrinsic to the cell that are called cell autonomous factors that play a role in the disease and in the aggregation process. They contribute to the selectivity of the aggregation process. So that's why we refer right now to prion-like spreading, because it recapitulates some features of the prion protein, but not all of them. Let's talk now about alpha-synuclein modification and how they could play a role in the disease process. So here on this drawing, you have an illustration of the protein and some of the modifications it can undergo. And as you can see, alpha-synuclein is a small protein, but it can undergo a large number of modifications. Some of them are called ubiquitination, meaning that there is a chain of a protein called ubiquitin that's going to bind to any of these spots. Some modifications are called phosphorylation, meaning that there is a phosphate residue that's going to be attached in different parts of the protein. Some of them also are called proteolysis or truncation, meaning that the protein is going to be cut in a different part in its terminal domain. Some of these modifications do occur under normal conditions. And some of these modifications can potentially impact the conformation, so the shape of alpha-synuclein, its solubility or aggregation capacity, its interaction with some other molecules, and its degradation. And I will now illustrate with two examples the relevance of this modification for MSA and how we can try to target them. First one is the truncation. Truncation is when the protein is going to be cut at the end, here, leading to a truncated protein that is only 120 amino acids instead of 140. Truncated forms of alpha-synuclein have been described in PD, in MSA, and in dementia with Lewy body. And we know that truncated alpha-synuclein can promote the formation of oligomers and fibrils. So these mechanisms is relevant for the aggregation process. Several enzymes have been identified as being able to cut alpha-synuclein in its terminal part, and one of them is caspase 1. So the idea here was to determine if we can provide neuroprotection in MSA by inhibiting the truncation of alpha-synuclein with a caspase 1 inhibitor. So to do so, we use the molecule that's called VX765, which is a caspase 1 inhibitor. And we perform this study in a mouse model of MSA. So these are mice that express alpha-synuclein in oligodendrocytes. They've been genetically modified in order to recapitulate this feature of MSA. What we could first show is that caspase 1 inhibition was able to reduce the truncation of alpha-synuclein. Here you have the truncated form of alpha-synuclein in the animals treated with VX765. And as you can see, you have less than in animals treated with placebo. Reducing the amount of truncated alpha-synuclein was also able to lead to a reduction of oligomers. So this high order assembly of alpha-synuclein, as you can see here, the mice treated with VX has much less oligomers than the mice treated with placebo. We could confirm that reducing the alpha-synuclein truncation could lead to a decreased burden of alpha-synuclein. So the alpha-synuclein inclusions are the small brown dots that you can see here on the pictures. And the animals treated with VX765 had much less inclusions than the ones treated with placebo. And finally, with regard to neurodegeneration, we could show that reducing alpha-synuclein truncation was able to prevent the neurodegeneration in this model. As you can see, these are the number of neurons in the different groups. Here are the mouse model of MSA treated with placebo, where you can see that there are less neurons, and we could prevent this loss of neurons with the treatment with VX765. So truncation is a mechanism that is relevant to the disease and that is can be targeted in the mouse model at least. Then another example of modification of alpha-synuclein is phosphorylation. So the addition of a phosphate group to the protein, it can be done at several sites. And I will focus on this one, residue Y39. Phosphorylation of Y39 has been described in Parkinson's disease. And among the molecules that can do this phosphorylation, one enzyme called CABL is responsible, at least in part, for the phosphorylation of this residue. And CABL can be inhibited by nilotinib, a drug used in the treatment of chronic myeloid leukemia. You have probably heard of nilotinib since there was a large media coverage following a small clinical trial that was later followed up by two clinical trials that are performed in Parkinson's disease. So the question here is this mechanism relevant to MSA? And this is a study that we've performed and that was sponsored by the MSA Coalition, in which we tested the effect of nilotinib in the mouse model of MSA. But the first step was to determine whether phosphorylation of alpha-synuclein at the specific residue Y39 would occur in MSA. As you can see here, these are alpha-synuclein-containing inclusions, and using an antibody that recognizes specifically alpha-synuclein when it's phosphorylated on that residue Y39, we could show that most of the inclusion, over 90% of the inclusion, contain alpha-synuclein phosphorylated at Y39. Here you have a higher magnification picture where you can see phosphorylated alpha-synuclein at Y39 in an oligodendrocyte in an MSA brain. So phosphorylation of Y39 does occur in MSA, and so the mechanism is potentially relevant for the disease. Then what are the effects of nilotinib in the mouse model of MSA? Here again, the first step was to determine whether there would be an increased phosphorylation of alpha-synuclein at Y39 in the mouse model, to determine whether the mouse model was suitable for the study. As you can see here, we have increased levels of alpha-synuclein phosphorylated at Y39 in the transgenic mouse model of MSA. And as you can see here, Wild-type mice, so normal animals, express to some extent Y39 alpha-synuclein, meaning that this phosphorylation is also present to some extent in under normal condition, but it is increased in the mouse model of MSA, as it is the case in the human disease. We then determine whether the administration of nimotinib would be able to reduce this amount of alpha-synuclein phosphorylated at Y39, and that was actually the case. We tried two different doses of nimotinib, 1 and 10 milligrams per kilo, and in both cases, we had a significant decrease in the amount of alpha-synuclein phosphorylated at Y39. We then wanted to look at the overall burden of alpha-synuclein inclusion in the brain, so using an antibody that recognizes all forms of alpha-synuclein, and an antibody that recognizes another phosphorylation that been implicated in synucleinopathy, that is the phosphorylation at residue 129. And in both cases, despite a reduction of alpha-synuclein phosphorylated at this residue Y39, there was no decrease in the total burden of alpha-synuclein assessed with any of these two markers. So nilotinib did not decrease the overall number of alpha-synuclein inclusions. We then looked at neurodegeneration. As you can see here, the mice, the mouse model of MSA display a loss of neurons in the brain. And unfortunately, the administration of nilotinib was not able to prevent the loss of neurons in this MSA mouse model. So to conclude and to tell you a little bit about the future and ongoing direction, so alpha-synuclein is a protein that can undergo a large number of modifications. Some of them occur under normal conditions. Some of them seem to be more specifically associated with the disease. Some of these modifications may play an important role in the aggregation and in the disease process. Some strains of alpha-synuclein that are unique to MSA have been identified. So this was an important recent discovery. Modifications of alpha-synuclein can be targeted for therapeutic development in order to reduce alpha-synuclein aggregation and neurodegeneration. But as you can see from the two examples I gave with different outcomes, one of them, the truncation being successful, whereas the division of phosphorylation at Y39 did not. And then the ongoing research and questions are what drives the formation of one strain over another, because we know that even in MSA, there are so far two, but maybe even more strains. So what makes the formation of one strain instead of another? And then what are the properties of each strain? Do some of them target more oligodendrocytes, more neurons? And what are the relationships between the modification of alpha-synuclein, such as the example I gave, and the formation of specific strains? And then also, what are the relationships between some specific strains and some specific patterns of disease progressions? And answering those questions is important not only for a better understanding of MSA, but also to identify novel targets for the development of disease-modifying strategies. I hope you found this presentation useful, and I thank you for your attention.